The title of this message is Redemption Through Motherhood. That is not a reference to 1 Timothy 2:15, where Paul enjoins in some sense, and we could have a good exegetical conversation about it, some sense in which women are saved through childbearing in embracing that role. I'm not talking about women being saved by their own efforts, certainly, or even women being saved themselves through embracing that role, but rather about women saving other people as they embrace the role of motherhood. That's why the subtitle to this talk is Why Caring for Children is Caring for the World. We live in such a child-centric culture, we can forget how unique to this historical moment it is that parents would be devoted to their children, sometimes in healthy, sometimes in unhealthy ways. As one author has said, we don't have patriarchy or even matriarchy, but kindergarchy. However, it has not always been so. Far from it. If there was one dominant fact regarding children in the ancient world, it was their high mortality rates, especially among infants. Many newborns were stillborn or died in labor. Those who made it safely out of the womb often went hungry. There were in many places too little food, too many mouths to feed. Children were abandoned, exposed to the elements. They could be literally left on trash heaps to die. From about the 200s BC onward, the most common family in Greece was a one-child family. You may on occasion have seen parents with two sons, but it would have been very rare to see two daughters. Unwanted children were disposed of, sold into slavery. Others were aborted in the womb. Many more were simply killed as infants. Newborns were not considered part of the family until the father officially acknowledged them in some sort of religious ceremony. Can you imagine being in a society where small children, persons in the womb, are not considered persons with human rights until we deem them to have those rights? Scary. In the ancient world, it was uniquely the Jewish people who prohibited abortion and infanticide, the latter of which was not outlawed until Christianity took a privileged place in the empire. So say what you want about Christendom and how bad it was to have Christians in charge, but at least the children could live. Christians have always opposed killing children, whether infants outside the womb or infants inside the womb. And was it not the founder of our faith, Jesus himself, who welcomed the little children when others wanted to push them away? Was it not Jesus who said the measure of our love for him would be measured by our love for these little children? And so he took them into his arms as if to say, honor these little ones and you honor me. Send them away because they're weak, insignificant, bothersome, and you have demonstrated that you do not understand the values of the kingdom. So if we are to honor the one who said this about children, and if we are to honor children as he taught us, then surely we must honor the women who give birth to these children and uniquely love and care for these children. As it's already been said, I've been preaching through Exodus. I tend to not preach the sermons when I'm on a treadmill, but I'm glad that others can listen to them, though perhaps they would be shorter if I did. And I'm just trying to get this so it doesn't sound like, if the thunder is going to come, I want it to be not by the microphone. I wonder if you've ever noticed in the Exodus story the role women played in the deliverance of God's people. I want to read to you 10 verses from Exodus chapter 2. Now a man from the house of Levi went and took as his wife a Levite woman. No, let's just see. Let's just see how it goes, but that's good. It's always nervous. You're preaching. Strong people are coming up behind you. Visions of WrestleMania in my mind or something. Now a man from the house of Levi went and took as his wife a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine child, she hid him 3 months because of Pharaoh's decree. When she could hide him no longer, she took for him a basket made of bulrushes and daubed it with bitumen and pitch. She put the child in it and placed it among the reeds by the river bank. And his sister stood at a distance to know what would be done to him. Now the daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river while her young woman walked beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her servant woman, and she took it. When she opened it, she saw the child, and behold, the baby was crying. She took pity on him and said, "This is one of the Hebrews' children." Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and call you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you?" And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Go." So the girl went and called the child's mother. And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child away and nurse him for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed him. When the child grew older, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. She named him Moses because she said, "I drew him out of the water." This section may be labeled in your Bible the birth of Moses, which it is. I think you could also call the section Three Women and No Funeral. What we have here is a story of three women, different ages, two different nationalities, different social standing, all doing their part to fulfill God's plan of redemption, though none of them could have possibly understood the role that they were playing. Three women. You have Moses' mother. We should not think of her as a weak character who's just sending off her child in a veil of tears, just not knowing what to do, but she is a woman of courage and creativity. We know later her name is Jochebed. When you think about it, her actions are really the inverse of what we see with Abraham and Isaac in Genesis 22. Abraham obeyed God's order to kill his son, and yet his son was spared. Moses' mother disobeys the order to kill her son, or give him up to be killed, and therefore her son is spared. As one commentator said, in one incident God honors obedience, in the other he honors defiance. It was an act of courage. Hebrews tells us, by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents because they saw the child was beautiful and they were not afraid of the king's edict. There's a verse for us in our fast-changing world, especially when it comes to all these matters of children, of gender, of sexuality. By faith, they were not afraid of the king's edict. She was courageous, she was creative, I have to think, that there was some sort of plan afoot. It was not by accident, I think, that Moses' sister, mom's daughter, happened to be there. Float the child down to the Egyptians, send your daughter to spy things out, give her a plan, give her words to say if the baby is found. Certainly the basket was better than nothing, and harder, too. What can be harder than for a mother to give her baby away? Yet what takes more courage than to give up a child when you know that the only way for this child to have life is that you might release it? If you want to preach a powerful sermon on adoption, you could do worse than to go to this text. Imagine the rejoicing Moses' mother had to have Miriam come back and say, "You get to keep Moses. You get to get paid to be his mom." And then imagine the trauma maybe 2-3 years later in that culture when the child was fully weaned, to now let go of the child that was all along more God's than it was her own. Jochebed was a woman of courage and creativity. And then you have Moses' sister, resolute, resourceful. Again, I have to think that Miriam was part of the plan, whether of her own initiative or more likely her mom. The way that it's described here, the sister, verse 4, stood at a distance to know what would be done to him, is the same expression used in Esther 2:11. Every day Mordecai walked in front of the court of the harem to learn how Esther was and what was going to happen. This is not just right person in the right place at the right time, but this is a part of some plan that the sister is there. Probably some conversation, okay? You trail behind, and perhaps you'll be found. It's off, and I'll use this. Some sort of plan for Miriam to be there, perhaps then when one of the court of Pharaoh's women, Pharaoh's daughter perchance, finds him and then asks, she would be there, ready to give a response to say, I could find someone to nurse this child. That is the kind of big sister you want. Like many of the big sisters would say, I've never seen this kid before. Take him, good luck. Did she have to communicate in a language that was not even her first language, in Egyptian, perhaps? This is a young girl who is resolute, resourceful, committed to doing what she can to help her little brother. And then you have Moses' adopted mother. She too may have been risking her neck. We don't know. Did Pharaoh care that she did this? Maybe this happened on other occasions. Maybe this was a part of the protocol as the edict went out and children were being pushed down the Nile River. Maybe Pharaoh thought, well, the fear is that this nation is getting bigger than we can handle, so if we find one of their children, then we'll make it an Egyptian, and so it's a loss for them and a win for us. We don't know what risks she might have taken, or if it was simply a sweetly human maternal thing for this princess to take in this child. If Moses' mother was courageous and his sister resolute and resourceful, then this new mom was powerful and yet full of pity. Now, was she duped? Did she know this was the child's sister who was then getting the baby's mother? Or could she see through it and know this is a little too convenient? We don't know. What we do know is that this is a beautiful picture of common grace. Here's a woman of great power and prestige, simply caring for a crying baby. She had mercy on a helpless child. A beautiful thing for anyone to do. A sweetly maternal thing for this princess. I've seen it many times. We have six kids. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. And then the next question always is, oh, ho, ho, you're probably expecting. Well, we are, so there. But, no, don't clap for me, clap for my wife. It's amazing. Just yesterday, my six-year-old, I overheard him ask, so Mom, do boys ever have the babies? My wife said, no, they don't. Phew, then I want like 150. So we'll get to that issue later. We're going to get passport to identity very soon. But I have seen it many times, maybe walking on a plane somewhere, and if you have children in tow with you, let alone a whole army of them, you can just see, and you see in the faces of the men often, a look as if they are now praying for the first time in years as you come down. Please, no. And so often it's a smile from a woman, grandma, a mother. Are these all yours? God bless you. That's wonderful. This story of this Egyptian woman, you could almost call the parable of the good Egyptian. She takes pity upon this child. The oppressors, now one of them at least, to care for the slave child. You may have read this story before as the story about the birth of Moses, which it is, but it is also the story of three remarkable women. Have you ever noticed, more often than not, when a woman shows up in the Bible, something good is going to happen? Now, I know not always. There's Jezebel, there's Adaliah, but most often, something remarkable is going to happen. Here's a Sarah, a Rahab, a Deborah, a Ruth, an Esther, an Abigail, a Mary Magdalene, Mary and Martha, Mary the mother of Jesus, the woman who supported Jesus, the women who repented of their sins before Jesus, the women healed by Jesus, the women at the empty tomb. Something good is going to happen. And there's some women here, and there's a lot of men, as there will be at the conference this week, pastors, leaders. And most of you are married to, many of you married to women, and you are pastoring women. And these women are incredibly overwhelmed, busy, tired, especially the ones with children, grandchildren in the house, running around. And if you think that they're going through their days just from strength to strength, just feeling so confident that they're doing a wonderful job as a mother, oh, no, no, no. To talk to a mom is to talk inevitably to someone who thinks they're doing a terrible job, unfortunately. And to talk to a mother is probably to talk to someone who is absolutely exhausted. And to talk to a mother is to talk to someone who's wondering, is anything in my life really matter right now? And there's a temptation to think as a mother, as one caring for children, you know, 20 years from now, I'll do something that matters for the Lord. My goals for today are to wake up and not die or kill anyone. That's it. Well, I don't know what God is up to in your life, or through your life, or because of your life. But here's what we know from the first chapter and a half of Exodus. And we haven't even talked about Exodus 1. Up to this point in the book, the great story of God's great redemption, the entire story of the ultimate example of deliverance in the Old Testament, has been moved forward by women. Specifically, and up to this point only, by women caring for children. We didn't even talk about the midwives, Shifra and Pua, in chapter 1. And then we have Jochebed and Miriam and Pharaoh's daughter. Women of different ethnicity, different age, different social standing. God using each of them in ways they could not possibly understand to fulfill God's great plan of deliverance. And what is their part to play, which they did not see or fathom? They loved children. Moms, your labors are not in vain. The labor, and then a lifetime of labors. And men, you need to tell the women in your congregation that their labors are not in vain. They need to hear it from you, their preacher. They need to hear it from you, husband. They need to hear it as you come home and you thank them for what they are doing. Do you want to make a difference in the world? Do you want to have a missional influence in your community? Do you want to play a part in God's divine plan of deliverance? Exodus 1 and 2 shows us, love children. The question is not whether women will someday find something truly useful to do like men. The real question is whether men will spend their lives doing something even half as important as being a mother. As Jesus said, whoever receives one such child in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me. If you want to care for the world, care for children. Amen.